Hebrews, come on in, find a seat. Please find a seat so we can get started. Okay, we ask the sisters to please cover your heads. Sisters, cover your heads. Brothers, uncover your heads. We're going to stand and face Jerusalem. Our Father which art in heaven,
our Father which art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done in earth.
Thy will be done in earth.
As it is in heaven.
As it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread.
Give us this day our daily bread.
And forgive us our debts.
And forgive us our debts.
As we forgive our debtors.
As we forgive our debtors.
And lead us not into temptation. But deliver us from evil.
But deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom.
For thine is the kingdom.
And the power.
And the power.
And the glory.
And the glory.
Forever.
Forever.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
For he is good.
For he is good.
For his mercy endureth forever.
For his mercy endures forever.
Praise the Lord God of Israel.
Praise the Lord God of Israel.
For he is good.
For he is good.
For his mercy endureth forever.
For his mercy endures forever.
In Jesus' name we pray.
In Jesus' name we pray.
The Holy One of Israel.
The Holy One of Israel.
The King of Kings.
The King of Kings.
And Lord of Lords.
And Lord of Lords.
Amen.
Amen.
Today's scripture reading comes from Proverbs 17, verses 17, 19, 20, 27, and 28. And they read, "The beginning of strife is as when one letteth out water. Therefore leave off contention before it be meddled with. A friend loveth at all times, and a brother is born for adversity. He loveth transgression that loveth strife, and he that exalteth his gate seeketh destruction. He that have a forward heart findeth no good, and he that have a perverse tongue falleth into mischief. He that hath knowledge spareth his words, and a man of understanding is of excellent spirit. Even a fool, when he holdeth his peace, is counted wise, and he that shutteth his lips is esteemed a man of understanding." May the Lord add a blessing to the reading, hearing, and doing of his word in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen. Okay, now we're going to have a couple of selections from the adult choir.
Let's make his praise glorious. Oh, yes. Hey.
When you come into his presence, lifting up the name of Jesus.
And you hear.
You hear the music playing, singing praise with understanding.
Take no thought.
Take no thought for tomorrow. Casting all your cares upon you.
Don't you wait.
Wait another minute. Just get up
and on your feet and. Shouting,
making loud and making glorious.
Start rejoicing, praising,
lifting,
making loud and make his praise glorious. Let's make it glorious. you wait.
Don't you wait another minute.
Just get up and on your feet and dancing, singing,
jumping, leaping, get to shouting,
make it loud and
glorious.
Start rejoicing,
start rejoicing,
praising,
praising,
lifting,
lifting, raising, get to shouting,
make it loud and
make his praise.
Get to dancing,
dancing,
singing,
singing, jumping.
Stop rejoicing,
rejoicing,
praising,
praising,
lifting,
lifting, raising, get to shouting,
make it loud and
make it praise.
Glorious, glorious, let's make it glorious.
Come on, come on, y'all.
All that is in it in me,
yeah,
will bless his holy name.
All right,
that's right. Cause
praise the Lord. Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
You know why? The priests have fallen fast asleep. They are selling straw for wheat, yet people believe. Jesus said, don't be deceived. Idolatry's the reason why choose death instead of life. Every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. Beauty for ashes,
oil of joy for sadness,
garment of praise, garment of praise. We will be gathered. No more shame or pain. A planting of the Lord,
planting of the Lord,
can be glorified. So why do the preachers lie? Ooh. Exchanging the truth for lies.
Ooh.
Giving you death, not life. This is life or death. Get this right. The tribulation, it will come. The place of safety, we will run. All who are called, the hidden ones, the ones he scattered to every land, whose sons and daughters were bought by man. We'll be gathered one by one from every nation.
Okay, let's get a choir another hand, y'all. Beauty for ashes. Praise to the Most High God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and peace to everyone that's here. In the name of Jesus, peace to everyone that's watching us live on the internet and listening in on the phone lines. And as always, it's good to stand before you on the Lord's Sabbath day. And this is what we do. We read this book, and we get some understanding. And today we're going to deal with a short lesson called The Thoughts of the Mind. It's relatively short because I got a lot of one-hitters up in here, so it's going to go pretty smooth, but it's going to read like a book. Because we know, as a servant of God, we have to have good works. But those good works also have to start here. Okay, you can come here on the Sabbath day, keep the feast days, dietary, all that good stuff, but if your mind ain't right, the Lord could care less about you. You might as well go and start back sinning again. So you can't play Sabbath. You can't fool the Lord. And that's what we're going to get out of this lesson. We know you got some good thoughts. Good thoughts bring forth good works. Evil thoughts bring forth evil works. And this lesson is going to show you. So let's deal with it right now. We're going to get into Proverbs. We're going to start it off in Proverbs. Because we know everybody can have an evil thought. I mean, living in this world, you can't help it. But you have to control them thoughts. Because if you don't control them, they're going to take over. And you're going to start doing some things as a servant of God you're not supposed to do.
Preach.
And if you continue down that path, Like it says in Ezekiel 18, the righteous man can turn away from his righteousness and start committing iniquity. So let's go to Proverbs 20. Proverbs 20. And we're going to start at verse 9. Proverbs 20 and verse 9. Okay, read.
Who can say, I have made my heart clean. I am pure from sin.
So who can say that? Who can say that? Raise your hand. Nobody. Nobody has made their heart clear, and it is not pure, and they are not free from sin. We have all sinned in one way or another, even after you come into this truth. One thing you don't want to do is sin willfully. Ignorant sin, the Lord can overlook that. But sinning willfully, ain't no coming back from that. You got to take your punishment. Skip down to verse 11 and read it.
Even a child is known by his doings, whether his work be pure or whether it be right.
So even a child is known by his doings, whether it be good or whether it be right. That's why you have to teach a child. Because if you don't, the child is going to grow up in this world and they're going to be wicked. Because the world is wicked. Turn your TV on. The world is wicked. And we have to protect our children from that. Preach. And then once they get outside of the house, you got to look at these billboards. You got to look at people walking down the street. All wicked. So you don't want to let your child be influenced by what the world is doing. So you teach them. Skip down to verse 27 and read it.
The spirit of a man is the candle of the Lord, searching all the inward parts of the belly.
So the spirit of the man is a candle of the Lord. And we ain't talking about some little entity inside of you. We're talking right here.
Right.
That's just right. Like when you read a comic book. You see, the only way you know what the cartoon is saying is you see that big bubble up the side and it got the words in it.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way your mind is when it comes to the Lord. That's your spirit. The spirit of the mind is like a candle to the Lord. He can see everything you think. Whatever you think, whatever language it in, because the Lord know all the languages.
Preach.
It's like a comic book to him. He can see it. He can look right in your mind. I'm telling you. You can't fool God. Go to Psalm 139. Psalm 139. So we got to keep our minds in check. All of us. It's a hard road to toe.
Man.
Because we came out of the world and the world is tugging back at us. It's pulling on our coattails. Come on back. It's all, it ain't that bad. Really? Psalm 139, and pick it up at verse 1. Read it.
O Lord, thou hast searched me and known me. Thou knowest my downsitting and mine uprising. Thou understandest my thought afar off.
So he says, look, O Lord, you have searched me and known me. And how did the Lord search him? Right here in his mind. He's looking right in your head. Thou hast known me. You know my going downs. I mean, my downsitting and mine uprising. You know me when I'm going to sleep. And you know me when I'm getting up. Because you're looking right in my head. Even when you sleep, we're going to show you the Lord is watching you. He can see everything you dream. Because if he didn't put that dream in there, because he said in Deuteronomy, he speaks to his prophets to what, a dream
mm-hmm.
or a vision?
Mm-hmm.
So if he didn't put that in you, somebody else did. Keep reading.
3, thou compassest my path and my lying down and art acquainted with all my ways. For there is not a word in my tongue, but lo, O Lord, thou knowest altogether.
That's right. Skip down to 23 and read it.
Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts.
Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know what I'm thinking. Keep reading.
And see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting.
So if my mind is messed up, Lord, please help me find the right direction so I can get that everlasting life.
Man.
That's a prayer for every day. If there's anything wrong with me, please show me the way. 1 Chronicles 28. 1 Chronicles 28. Let's look at the instructions David gave Solomon. 1 Chronicles 28. We're going to read one verse. Verse 9. 1 Chronicles 28 and verse 9. Okay, read.
And thou, Solomon, my son, know thou the God of thy father and serve him with a perfect heart and with a willing mind.
So Solomon, David is telling Solomon, look, serve God with what? A perfect heart and a willing mind. That's the same thing. Heart and the mind are one together. A perfect heart and a willing mind. Go ahead.
For the Lord searcheth all hearts and understandeth all the imaginations of the thoughts. If thou seek him, he will be found of thee. But if thou forsake him, he will cast thee off forever.
So the Lord searches just the hearts of the righteous.
No.
He searches all the hearts. And he says, if thou understandeth all the imaginations of thoughts, if you seek him, he will be found. But if you will forsake him, he will cast you off. It's a done deal. He will cast you off. So that covers the righteous and the wicked.
Yes, sir.
The Lord is even-handed. He looked at all hearts. He reads all minds. Let's go to Genesis 9. I'm going to slow down. This green stuff has got me going. I'm going a million miles an hour. Genesis 9. Now, Genesis 6 will tell you that the man's thoughts was wicked continually. So what did the Lord do? Drowned everybody except for Noah and his family.
Right.
So now let's see. After the waters receded, Noah and his family came out of the ark. Let's see what the Lord said. Genesis 9, verse 20. Read it.
And Noah began to be a husbandman, and he planted a vineyard.
I'm sorry, verse 8. Genesis 8.
Oh.
Where I get 9 from? Is that you or me?
That is you, sir.
That's me?
Yes, sir.
What's on the paper? It's 8 and 20. That's a typo. All right, you off the hook this time. Genesis 8, verse 20. Read it.
And Noah building an ark unto the Lord and took of every clean beast and of every clean fowl and offered burnt offerings on the altar. And the Lord smelled a sweet savor. And the Lord said in his heart, I will not again curse the ground any more for man's sake, for the imagination of man's heart is evil from his youth. Neither will I again smite any more every living thing as I have done.
And thank the Lord that he promised that.
Man.
Because if he didn't make that promise, I guarantee you we'd be sitting underwater right now. Because this world has gone back to where it used to be. Wicked. And the imagination of man's heart is evil from where? From his youth. Nothing has changed. Let's go to Ephesians 6. So how do we combat this evilness, these evil thoughts? You submerge yourself in this book. You drown yourself in this book. Cast out all them evil thoughts that's coming. The only way to do that is to put on that armor. Ephesians 6. We're going to pick it up at verse 10. Ephesians 6 and 10. Read it.
Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might.
So finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord. You can't do this by yourself. And the power of his might, go ahead.
Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil.
So put on the whole armor of God, the whole armor, so you'll be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Go ahead, verse 12.
For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places.
And that's what we're wrestling against, spiritual wickedness in high places. All out there in the world, you can see it. Wickedness is everywhere. And Satan is the god of this world, and he's running it. That's why it's so evil. Man has a choice, though. You don't have to do evil.
Right.
The Lord made you a free agent. He told you in Deuteronomy 30 to do what? Choose life and death. Which one do you want? The choice is yours. But the majority of mankind has chosen wickedness. Wickedness to blatant wickedness or wickedness that's real subtle like sun worship. But it's all wicked in the Lord's eyes. Verse 13, read it.
Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in an evil day, and having done all to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God.
And that is your whole armor. The shield of faith, your loins girt about with the truth, the breastplate of righteousness, feet shod with the gospel of peace, helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Bible knowledge.
Yes, sir.
Will get you past these evil thoughts. They will not be able to produce evil works. They'll pop up in your head, because sometimes you might, man, why did I do that? Where did that thought come from? You know? You just shake it off and keep moving. Let's go to
18.
Read 18 too.
Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints.
So take that whole armor of God and do well. What else you got to do? You got to pray. Yes. Always. Every day. Three times a day. Morning, evening. Morning, noon, and evening. For starters. Right. A minimum.
Right.
Three times a day. Praying always. Okay, let's go to 1 Corinthians 9. 1 Corinthians 9. So you got to keep your thoughts in check, brothers and sisters. Because if you don't, they're going to take over. And we're going to see you on the news. If it gets to that extreme. Or you just might stop showing up here. Or if you're here, you might start doing things you ain't supposed to do. So keep your thoughts in check. 1 Corinthians 9:16, read it.
For though I preach the gospel, and have nothing to glory of, for necessity is laid upon me, yea, whole is unto me, if I preach not the gospel. For if I do this thing willingly, I have a reward. But if against my will, a dispensation of the gospel is committed unto me.
Go ahead.
What is my reward then? Verily that, when I preach the gospel, I may make the gospel of Christ without charge, that I abuse not my power in the gospel. For though I be free from all men, yet have I made myself a servant unto all, that I might gain the more.
And that's the advantage of coming out of this world, knowing the truth. You can deal with people on their level and try to bring them in. Because there's certain people you can talk to this way, certain people you can talk to that way. But the whole point is to get them to understand so they can come into the word of God. So you have to be like Paul said, you got to be all things to all people. Okay. Go ahead.
20. And unto the Jews, I became as a Jew, that I might gain the Jews, to them that are under the law, as under the law, that I might gain them that are under the law, to them that are without the law, as without the law, being not without law to God, but under the law to Christ, that I might gain them that are without law. To the weak became I as weak, that I might gain the weak. I am made all things to all men, that I might by all means save some.
That he might save some. All of them ain't going to get saved, but you still, as a servant of God, it is your job to try to do the best that you can. Don't be one talent and bury it.
Preach.
You got this truth. You are obliged and compelled to get out there and try to win some souls for the Lord. Keep reading.
23. And this I do for the gospel's sake, that I might be partaker thereof with you. Know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize? So run that ye may obtain. And every man that striveth for the mastery is tempered in all things. Now, they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible.
So everybody that crossed the finish line is only one gold medal in man's world. But in God's world, Just make it across the finish line. Mm-hmm. Just make it across that line. I don't care how slow you are or how fast you are. Just make it. The finish line is right there. Mm-hmm. However long it takes you to get there, you keep running that race and fighting that fight, and eventually you will make it to that finish line. Keep reading.
I therefore so run, not as uncertainty, so fight I, not as one that beateth the air, but I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway.
So after doing all this, after becoming all things to all people to gain them, if I go back door, it's all for nothing. That's why he says I have to keep my body and bring it into subjection. Mm-hmm. And how do you do that? Control this right here.
Man.
This is the only way to control your body. Now let's go to Mark 7. Mark chapter 7. Let's get to these thoughts of the mind since we done laid the foundation down. Mm-hmm. Mark 7. Let you know what Jesus said. Mark chapter 7. And we're going to pick it up at verse 14. Mark 7 and 14. Okay, read.
And when he had called all the people unto him, he said unto them, hearken unto me, every one of you, and understand. There is nothing from without a man that entereth into him can defile him, but the things which come out of him, those are they that defile that the man.
So we know the story of this. The Pharisees was jumping on Jesus' disciples because they didn't wash their hands when they ate.
Right.
So if you don't wash your hands when you eat, that makes your food dirty. So if you eat dirty food, that makes you dirty. But Jesus said, look, you can eat dirty food all you want. That ain't going to mess you up. Mm-hmm. It's what comes out of you that's going to mess you up. Keep reading. I mean, skip down to verse 20 and read it.
And he said, that which cometh out of the man, that defileth the man.
So that what comes out of a man, that's what messes you up. Go ahead.
For from within, out of the heart of men, proceed evil thoughts.
From within, out of the mind of men, because thought precedes action.
Yes, sir.
You have to think about something before you do it. Thought precedes action. From within, well, keep reading. Go ahead.
Proceed evil thoughts.
Evil thoughts from within. Evil thoughts start in the mind. Let's look at some of them. Go ahead.
Adultery.
Adultery.
Fornication.
Fornication.
Murders.
Murder.
Thefts.
Thefts.
Covetousness.
Covetousness.
Wickedness.
Wickedness.
Deceit.
Deceit.
Lasciviousness.
Lasciviousness.
An evil eye.
An evil eye. An evil eye in the mind. Looking at somebody crazy and then thinking crazy. Hmm. Go ahead.
Blasphemy, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within and defile the man.
So all these evil things come from the mind. And that's what defiles a man, because if you continue with these evil thoughts, it's going to produce evil works. People just don't go out and commit murder. They think about it first. People plan robberies, mm-hmm, so you don't get caught. Mm-hmm. Embezzlement, all this stuff. Adultery. People plan this stuff. You got to think about it. Let's go to Proverbs 15. Proverbs 15. Let's look at some evil thoughts. Kind of did a little color thing with the lesson so you know what we're dealing with.
Good stuff.
So everything and every color is a different evil thought.
All right.
Proverbs 15. And then we're going to get some examples of these evil thoughts. Proverbs 15, 1 verse 26. Read it.
The thoughts of the wicked are an abomination to the Lord, but the words of the pure are pleasant words.
So the thoughts of the wicked are an abomination to the Lord, because we read in the book where he sees all minds, all hearts, he's looking at them.
Yes, sir.
So the mind of the wicked person is an abomination to the Lord, just like eating swine. abomination. Proverbs 30. Flip right over to Proverbs 30. Read one verse there, verse 32. Okay, read.
If thou hast done foolishly in lifting thyself, in lifting up thyself, or thou hast thought evil, lay thine hand upon thy mouth.
So if thou hast done foolishly in lifting up yourself, that's pride. Or if thou hast thought evil, lay your hand on your mouth.
Real talk.
Put your hand over your mouth, because I'm guaranteeing if you start thinking evil, you're going to start talking evil. So you better put a gag order on your mouth if you're thinking crazy. But then we shouldn't be thinking crazy because we're servants of the Lord, right?
Theoretically.
Let's go to 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 1, 4. 1 Peter chapter 4. We're going to pick it up at verse 1. 1 Peter 4 and verse 1. Okay, read.
For as much then as Christ hath suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind. For he had that hath suffered in the flesh hath ceased from sin.
So just like Christ suffered in the flesh, we got to arm ourselves what? With the same mind as Christ. Okay? For he that hath suffered in the flesh hath ceased from sin. It's an ongoing process. We have to fight this good fight because it's easy to sin, real easy. But you got to bring your body into subjection. So when you do all that suffering, yeah, you have ceased from doing it because you're suffering. Go ahead.
2, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh to the lust of men, but to the will of God. For the times past of our life may suffice us to have wrought the will of the Gentiles, when we walked in lasciviousness, lust, excess of wine, revelings, banquetings, and abominable idolatries.
And we read that in Mark, right? Out of the mind proceeds evil thoughts. All this stuff right here. Excess of wine, revelings, banquetings, and abominable idolatries. Verse 4, read it.
Wherein they think it strange that ye run not with them to the same excess of riot, speaking evil of you.
So when you stop doing that, the kinfolk and your friends, they start thinking evil thoughts about you because you ain't doing what you used to do. Mm-hmm. Now you evil. Before you was good. But the world is evil.
Right.
So you started doing good, so now you evil. This world is messed up. Mm-hmm. That's why you got to submerge yourself. Put on that whole armor because it's coming. It's bad. It's bad out there, and it's getting worse and worse and worse. Let's go to Genesis 39. We're in a different color now. Genesis 39. Let's look at this. Genesis 39. Because out of the mind proceeds evil thoughts. And the next one on the list was adultery. Genesis 39. Let's pick it up at verse 1. And this is about Joseph. Everybody know about Joseph. His brothers gave him the 1-2. And he ended up in Egypt. But the Lord was with him and he prospered. So even in adverse situations, if you got the Lord on your side, it's all good. Mm-hmm. Especially when you get a trumped up charge or your family members don't like you. But anyway, 39:1, read it.
And Joseph was brought down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, bought him of the hands of the Ishmaelites, which had brought him down thither. And the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian.
So Joseph had a good job being a slave. He was a houseboy. Pretty much what he was. He was a good houseboy because the Lord was with him, and right. His master trusted him.
Right.
That's like certain inmates in prison. Some have better jobs than others because mm-hmm. they can be trusted, even though you committed a crime and you locked up. You can still be trusted to a certain degree. Skip down to verse, keep reading, I'm sorry.
3. And his master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord made all that he did to prosper in his hand. And Joseph found grace in his sight and served him, and he made him overseer of his house and all that he had put into his hand.
Go ahead.
Skip.
Did we skip?
Do we skip now?
Wait a minute. Where am I at? Yeah, 1-4. Skip down to verse 7 and read.
And it came to pass after these things that his master's wife cast her eyes upon Joseph, and she said, "Lie with me." But he refused and said unto his master's wife, "Behold, my master wotteth not what is with me in the house, and he hath committed all that he hath to my hand. There is none greater in this house than I. Neither have he kept back anything from me but thee, because thou art his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God?"
So now here's a woman that's married. Nice husband, got a lot of money. But now she wants to commit adultery. She ain't got no shame. But Joseph, being a good man that fears the Lord, he like, no. But get somebody out there in the world, I guarantee you. If somebody else's wife is hitting on them, they will take it with no problem. Because mm-hmm. given the opportunity, and if you can get away with it, people will do it.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And that's just for real.
That's true. In the world.
So this woman had her eyes on Joseph. But Joseph, being a good man, said, "No, I can't do this. I cannot do this wicked thing." Go ahead.
10. And it came to pass, as she spake to Joseph day by day, that he hearkened not unto her to lie by her or be with her.
So now she's driving reckless on him every day because he can't go nowhere.
Right.
That's his job, to be the keeper of the house. So he got to avoid this woman all day.
Jeez.
Keep reading.
And it came to pass about this time that Joseph went into the house to do his business, and there was none of the men of the house here within. And she caught him by his garment, saying, "Lie with me." And he left his garment in her hand and fled and got him out.
So now there was nobody around but them two, so that was her chance. She was intent on getting this dude. Wicked thoughts. It ain't like, you know, she had planned this. She had planned this. Because all them other times, day by day, it had to be people around.
Ah, right.
But now this one time, all of a sudden, we are by ourselves. Now I'm going to get you. But we see Joseph did the best thing he could do, and that was run. But we know what happened. He ended up getting thrown in prison, you know. Got accused of rape and this and that, and they threw him in jail. Let's go to 2 Samuel. So Joseph was a righteous man, and he didn't do it. He didn't commit that adultery, even though the woman was pressing on him.
Mm-hmm. Every day.
But let's look at this guy. He succumbed to the temptation, and it cost him a whole lot.
Mm-hmm.
11. Man, these colors, I ain't doing this lesson in colors no more. It keeps messing me up. 2 Samuel 11. Start at verse 1. Okay, read.
And it came to pass, after the year was expired, at the time when kings go forth to battle, that David sent Joab and his servants with him in all Israel, and they destroyed the children of Amnon and besieged Rabbah. But David tarried still at Jerusalem. And it came to pass in evening tide that David arose from off his bed and walked upon the roof of the king's house. And from the roof, he saw a woman washing herself. And the woman was very beautiful to look upon.
So now around evening time, David got up off his bed. He was up on the roof. And he saw a woman taking a bath. And she was beautiful. He looked. And that was it. He looked. She was beautiful. And he looked. But he got to thinking. But anyway, verse 3, read it.
And David sent and inquired after the woman.
So now he's asking him, now who is this beautiful woman? Because if she was somebody single, then maybe, you know, because David already had a bunch of wives anyway. Maybe she was an eligible bachelorette. But what did they tell him? Go ahead.
And one said, is not this Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite?
Oh, man, he should have said, that's somebody's wife. Dog, let me go on back and go to sleep.
Right.
But the thought festered in his mind. They told him this was somebody's wife. Verse 4, go ahead.
And David sent his messengers and took her. And she came in unto him, and he lay with her. And she was purified from her uncleanliness. And she returned into her house.
So he sent his messengers, and they got her. They already told him, man, this is somebody's wife. That's a no-no. And this is a man after God's own heart. I guess his heart was somewhere else right here. It wasn't with God right here. But skip down to verse 5. Read verse 5. Go ahead.
And the woman conceived and sent and told David and said, I am with child.
Uh-oh. Now we got a problem. Skip down to verse, we finished that?
26.
Read 26. Go ahead.
And when the wife of Uriah heard that Uriah, her husband, was dead, she mourned for her husband. And when the mourning was past, David sent and fetched her to his house. And she became his wife and bare him a son. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord.
So David ended up having the woman's husband killed just to hide the pregnancy. But the thing that he did displeased the Lord. The Lord didn't like that. He didn't like it. He went from adultery to murder, trying to cover up what he had done. Let's go to Genesis 38. And let's look at fornication. It's all the same thing. We're dealing with the physical aspect here. We know there's two sides to adultery and fornication.
Yes, it is.
But we're just dealing with the thoughts right here. What you got up here. Genesis 38. So if you ain't thinking about it, it won't happen. If you think about it, shake it off. You think about it too long,
got a problem.
It's gonna happen. They told him that was somebody's wife. Man, no. I don't care. I'm gonna do this anyway. I'm the king. Genesis 38. And verse 1, read it.
And it came to pass at that time that Judah went down from his brethren and turned into a certain Adullamite whose name was Hira. And Judah saw there a daughter of a certain Canaanite whose name was Shual. And he took her and went into her.
Now this is Judah, okay? One of Jacob's sons. One of the 12 tribes of Israel. This is Judah. He found him a wife. Verse 3, read it.
And she conceived and bare a son, and he called his name Ur. And she conceived again and bare a son, and she called his name Onan. And she conceived and yet again conceived and bare a son, and called his name Shelah. And he was at Chezib when she bare him.
So this wife was very fruitful. Had him three sons. Skip down to verse 12 and read it.
And in process of time, the daughter of Shua, David's wife, Judah's wife died.
So now his wife died after so many years, process of time. We don't know how many years it is, but during that time, she ended up dying. Go ahead.
And Judah was comforted and went up unto his sheep shearers to Timnath, he and his friend Hira, the Adullamite.
So now he went up to the sheep shearers because they about to get something. He's comforted. He mourned. He's comforted now. Now he wants to get him something to eat. He's hanging with his boy. Go ahead, verse 13.
And it was told Tamar, saying, behold, thy father-in-law goeth up to Timnath to shear his sheep. And she put her widow's garments off from her and covered her with a veil and wrapped herself and sat in an open place, which is by the way to Timnath. For she saw that Shelah was grown, and she was not given unto him to wife.
So now the whole story behind this, Tamar was supposed to marry Judah's firstborn, but he was wicked, so the Lord killed him.
Right.
And the books say if the firstborn marries a woman, has no child, then the brother's supposed to go in
right.
and producer Aaron named it after him.
Right.
So the second boy went up into her, and he spilled his seed on the ground. Mm-hmm. So the Lord killed him. Mm-hmm. So now there's one boy left. So she said, he told her, look, go ahead and wait till he get grown, and then I'll give him to you. But during this time, Judah's wife died. He had forgot all about her, and old boy done grew up. Mm-hmm. So now she's looking. Tamar's looking and said, hold up. He out here having a good time. What about, where's my husband at, man?
Right.
So she put off her widow's garments and started dressing like a harlot. Go ahead.
When Judah saw her, he thought her to be in harlot.
He thought. Now he looking. Now your wife just died. The morning is over with. You're hanging out with your boys. What are you looking for? He thought this woman was a harlot. And what do harlots do? We know what they do. They sell themselves. But now, come on, Judah. What you thinking about, man? You just can't do this. Even though they out there, you're not supposed to do that. Go ahead. So he thought she was a harlot. Go ahead.
Because she had covered her face. And he turned unto her by the way and said, go to, I pray thee. Let me come unto thee. For he knew not that she was his daughter-in-law.
Let me come in unto thee.
Let me come in unto thee. For he knew not that she was his daughter-in-law. And she said, what wilt thou give me, that thou mayest come in unto me?
So I guess that was supposed to change something. He didn't know that was his daughter-in-law. So if he had found out that was his daughter-in-law, he wouldn't have did it. He would have found some other harlot. But you see what his mind was. He was intent on having some relations.
Mm-hmm.
Not with anybody to get a wife.
A harlot.
He just wants some passing by fancy in the night that you ain't got to worry about. But see, the Lord is watching. Go ahead.
And he said, I will send thee a kid from the flock. And she said, wilt thou give me a pledge till thou send it? And he said, what pledge shall I give thee? And she said, thy signet and thy bracelets and thy staff that is in thine hand. And he gave it to her. And came in unto her, and she conceived by him.
So he didn't have no money, so he got some credit. That's what it is. He got some relations on credit.
That is crazy.
Let's go to
Bible is crazy.
2 Samuel 13.
Some credit.
2 Samuel 13.
Wow.
But he was wrong for what he was doing. He right. had his mindset wasn't right.
Right.
Servants of God not supposed to deal with harlots.
Preach.
Second Samuel 13. So we know what happened to David. He committed adultery. Lord messed his house up. And this is incident number one right here. 2 Samuel 13, verse 1, read.
And it came to pass after this, that Absalom, the son of David, had a fair sister whose name was Tamar, and Amnon, the son of David, loved her.
So we got another Tamar incident right here, right? Go ahead.
And Amnon was so vexed that he fell sick for his sister Tamar, for she was a virgin. And Amnon thought it hard for him to do anything to her.
So now Amnon was from another mother. Absalom and Tamar was brother and sister.
Blood.
They had the same mother. But Amnon was so sick. He was so vexed with his sister that it made him sick.
Crazy.
Keep reading.
But Amnon had a friend whose name was Jonadab, the son of Shimea, David's brother. And Jonadab was a very subtle man.
So the man was so sick for his sister, he didn't know how to act on his sickness. So there's always somebody waiting in the wings to show you how to do this.
Sneaky sneak.
And here come his cousin, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the book tell you his cousin was a very subtle man. That means he was evil.
Mm-hmm. Slick.
So he showed him, this is how you do it, man. Keep reading.
4. And he said unto him, why art thou, being the king's son, lean from day to day? Would thou not tell me? And Amnon said unto him, I love Tamar, my brother Absalom's sister. And Jonadab said unto him, lay thee down on thy bed.
Now here's the, this is the plot now. This is how we're going to do this. Go ahead.
And make thyself sick. And when thy father cometh to see thee, say unto him, I pray thee, let my sister Tamar come and give me meat, and dress the meat in my sight, that I may see it and eat it at her hand. So Amnon lay down and made himself sick. And when the king was come to see him, Amnon said unto the king, I pray thee, let Tamar my sister come and make me a couple of cakes in my sight, that I may eat at her hand.
So now the plan is in motion. Cousin told him how to do it, and he going for it. So David came in there and said, look, what's wrong with you, man? He said, I'm sick. Let Tamar, my sister, come and I can eat out of her hand. Go ahead. And David didn't know what was going on. He think this is all innocent. Like, look, go and see your brother. He's sick. You make them good cakes like he like. He like your food. Go on over there and make him something to eat. Go ahead.
7. Then David sent home to Tamar, saying, go now to thy brother Amnon's house and dress him meat. So Tamar went to her brother Amnon's house, and he was laid down. And she took flour and kneaded it, and made cakes in his sight, and did bake the cakes. And she took a pan and poured them out before him, but he refused to eat. And Amnon said, have out all men from me. And they went out every man from him. And Amnon,
go ahead.
And Amnon said to her, unto Tamar, bring the meat into the chamber, that I may eat of thine hand. And Tamar took the cakes which she had made and brought them into the chamber to Amnon her brother. And when she had brought them unto him to eat, he took hold of her and said unto her, come lie with me, my sister.
So he sent everybody out. He couldn't wait for this now. The plan was his buddy hatched out the plan, and he could see it just going into motion. Everything is going the way it's supposed to be. Tamar is here. She's cooking for me. I'm laid up in the bed sick. I'm going to send everybody out. And she's going to come and feed me. And then he took her. Go ahead.
12. And she answered him, nay, my brother, do not force me, for no such thing ought to be done in Israel. Do not this folly.
So she was told him, look, man, this is crazy. You don't got to do this. This is insane.
Right.
Why are you doing this? Go ahead.
And I, whither shall I go? Shall I cause my shame to go? And as for thee, thou shalt be as one of the fools in Israel. Now, therefore, I pray thee, speak unto the king, for he will not withhold me from thee.
Now, she was doing some fast talking, but you know David wasn't about to do that. No. But there was a whole crowd to say, look, let's talk to the king. You know, we can. She was just trying to get up out of there. But he was so vexed with his sister, he was sick in his head, he wasn't even trying to hear it. Go ahead.
Howbeit, he would not hearken unto her voice, but being stronger than she, forced her and lay with her.
So he raped his own sister. That evil thought that he had help from his cousin, because he wasn't man enough to think of nothing on his own. Mm-hmm. The thought was already there. He just didn't know how to do it. He probably would have been sick the whole time. But here comes Jonadab. Here comes Satan. I'm going to show you how to do it, man. So we see what happened. Let's go to 15. Read that.
Then Amnon hated her exceedingly.
Wait a minute. I thought he loved her. Now he hated her after he done did what he wanted to do. Now he hated her. Because he had to rape her to get it. Now it's hate. Go ahead.
So that he hated, wherewith he hated her, was greater than the love wherewith he had loved her. And Amnon said unto her, arise, be gone.
So he told her, look, get out of my face. I guess he's well now, huh? His sickness is over with.
Yeah.
Let's go to Judges 9. Let's look at this murder. Because this is what defiles a man. Evil thoughts, adultery, fornication, and murder. But you got to think about it first. Nobody just wakes up in the morning and decides to kill 20 people.
Man.
You think about it. Look at these Gentiles that are shooting up these high schools and these colleges. Mm-hmm. Israel ain't doing that because we got metal detectors in our schools. They making sure we don't do it. That we the ones they ain't got to worry about.
Yeah.
They need to worry about them Gentiles. They got all the guns.
Yeah, man.
Judges 9 and verse 1. We're going to start there. Go ahead.
And Abimelech, the son of Jerubbaal, went to Shechem unto his mother's brethren and communed with them and with all the family of the house of his mother's father, saying.
Now, Abimelech was one of Gideon's sons. Gideon had 70 kids, but he had one by a concubine from another city.
Correct.
Okay. So now Gideon died. So now this Abimelech, he want to run it. Go ahead.
2. Speak, I pray you, in the ears of all the men of Shechem, whether it is better for you either that all the sons of Jerubbaal, which are 70 persons, reign over you, or that one reign over you. Remember also that I am bone of your flesh. And his mother's brethren spake of him, and in the ears of all the men of Shechem, all these words, and their hearts inclined to follow Abimelech, for they said, he is our brother.
So now Abimelech said, look, you want 70 people to rule over you or just one? And remember, I come from among y'all. We flesh and blood. I can do this. But I'm going to need y'all's help if you want me to do it. So they listened. He did some fast talking. They listened to him. And they said, okay, we're going to follow you because you are our brother. Let's see the plan that was hatched out. Go ahead.
4. And they gave him 70 pieces of silver out of the house of Baal Berith.
So now he got 70 pieces of silver. What you need money for if you want to be king? We're going to elect you king. Why you need money? Go ahead.
Wherewith Abimelech hired vain and light persons which followed him.
So he got 70 pieces of silver and he hired some thugs. That's what vain and light mean, a thug. Go ahead.
And he went into his father's house at Ophrah, and slew his brethren, the sons of Jerubbaal, being 70 persons upon one stone. Notwithstanding, yet Jotham, the youngest son of Jerubbaal, was left, for he hid himself.
So he took that money, hired him some thugs, went to his father's house, and killed 69 of his brothers. Now you tell me he wasn't thinking about that.
Huh.
That was a hatched out plan. Evil thought. Killed 69 of his brothers. One of them escaped, but go ahead.
6. And all the men of Shechem gathered together and all the house of Millo and went and made Abimelech king by the plain of the pillar that was in Shechem.
So now if all your brothers out the way, I'm the king. But the Lord weighed in on it. Skip down to verse 56. Because all the people that elected him king, they ended up turning on him. And it was an all-out battle between both of them. And this is coming from the Lord. Verse 56, read it.
Thus God rendered the wickedness of Abimelech, which he did unto his father in slaying his 70 brethren. And all the evil of the men of Shechem did God render upon their heads, and upon them came the curse of Jotham, son of Jerubbaal.
So they knew what he did. So the Lord turned the wickedness on both of them. He got the people that elected him king, and they got the king too. All this in-house fighting. Remember, he said, I'm bone of your flesh. So now they all fighting against each other, and they ended up getting killed. Let's go to look at something else. 1 Samuel 18. 1 Samuel 18. Man, all these evil thoughts, man. And this is Israel. People that got the one true living God going crazy. Nothing's changed. 1 Samuel 18. Start at verse 10. This is Saul right here. Go ahead.
And it came to pass on the morrow that the evil spirit from God came upon Saul, and he prophesied in the midst of the house, and David played with his hand as at other times, and there was a javelin in Saul's hand.
So now Saul got rejected from being king. David got anointed. So the spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and an evil spirit from the Lord came upon him. And every time that evil spirit was on him, Saul was looking to do something wrong, something evil. So once that evil spirit was on him, Saul prophesied in the midst, and then David played his harp. But there was a javelin in Saul's hand. And what did he want to do? Verse 11.
And Saul cast the javelin, for he said, I will smite David even to the wall with it. and David avoided out of his presence twice.
Now he said, I'm going to take this javelin, I'm going to kill David. All because of that evil thought. He was already distressed because the Lord had rejected him from being king. He should have just left it alone. Took your little punishment, went on about your business, but them thoughts was festering. I got to get rid of my competition. So I'm going to take this javelin and throw it at him and kill him. But David was wise on that. The Lord tipped him off and he scooted on out the back door. So now Saul had to figure out something else. Go ahead.
12. And Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with him and was departed from Saul.
Okay, skip down to verse 12. And wait a minute. 17. I'm sorry. 17. Read it.
And Saul said to David, behold, my elder daughter Merab, her will I give thee to wife. Only be thou valiant for me and fight the Lord's battles. For Saul said, let not mine hand be upon him, but let the hand of the Philistines be upon him.
So now he plotting out. He said, look, okay, I don't want to kill him. Because he was thinking about hitting him with that javelin. He's like, no. I'm going to send him out to battle. Let somebody else kill him. But go ahead.
And David said unto Saul, who am I? And what is my life for my father's family in Israel, that I should be son-in-law to the king? But it came to pass at that time, when Merab, Saul's daughter, should have been given to David, that she was given unto Adriel, the Methonite, to wife. And Michal, Saul's daughter, loved David. And they told Saul, and the thing pleased him. And Saul said, I will give him her, that she may be a snare to him, and that the hand of the Philistines may be against him. Wherefore Saul said to David, thou shalt this day be my son-in-law in the one of the twain.
So the first daughter he was promised, she was given to somebody else. But we see Michal loved him, and Saul was like, look, I'm going to give him Michal so she can be a snare unto him. So I don't know what kind of daughter he had.
He knew what he had.
Well, he knew he had, but apparently he was giving her to David to trip him up.
Exactly.
And the Philistines too. But keep reading.
22. And Saul commanded his servants, saying, commune with David secretly and say, behold, the king have delight in thee, and all his servants love thee. Now, therefore, be the king's son-in-law.
So you see, this plot is being hatched out. He's plotting to kill David. Evil thought. Go ahead.
And Saul's servant spake these words in the ears of David. And David said, seemeth it to you a light thing to be the king's son-in-law, seeing that I'm a poor man and lightly esteemed? And the servants of Saul told him, saying, on this matter spake David. And Saul said, thus shall ye say to David, the king desireth not any dowry, but 100 foreskins of the Philistines to be avenged of the king's enemies. But Saul thought to make David fall by the hand of the Philistines.
So he didn't want no dowry. He said, just go out there and fight them Philistines for me, man. Go ahead.
And when his servants told David these words, it pleased David well to be the king's son-in-law, and the days were not expired. Wherefore David arose and went, he and his men, and slew of the Philistines 200 men.
So he didn't think nothing of it. He loved it. I want to be the king. I'm going to do this. Let's go. Go ahead.
And David brought their foreskins and gave them in full tale to the king that he might be the king's son-in-law.
Now, he only wanted 100. But David brought him 200. And that really got him mad. Go ahead.
And Saul gave him Michal, his daughter, to wife. And Saul saw and knew that the Lord was with David and that Michal, Saul's daughter, loved him.
Okay, let's go to Genesis 37. 37 and verse 1. Let's look at Joseph and his brothers, because they hatched the plot out too. But you got to think about this stuff, though. That's the thing. Everything has to be thought out. You have to think out how you're going to serve the Lord. And it's right here in this book. You have to think out how you're going to do some evil stuff too. The same effort you used to put forth in all that other foolishness, it should be tripled when you're trying to do this.
Preach. Preach, brother.
Go ahead. Genesis 37 and 1. Go ahead.
And Jacob dwelt in the land wherewith his father was a stranger, in the land of Canaan. These are the generations of Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brethren. And the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought unto his father their evil report.
So Joseph was a snitch. He'd tell on his brothers. That's what it was. But go ahead.
3. Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children, because he was the son of his old age. And he made him a coat of many colors.
So he loved Joseph. Why? Because Joseph came out of Rachel.
Right.
And he loved Rachel.
Right.
He worked 14 years for her.
True.
Everybody else, all his first wife Leah, spitting out babies like it was nothing. Concubines, babies like it was nothing. But when he finally had a baby from the woman that he loved,
Right. Naturally
he gonna love this one more than the other ones. Because he loved Rachel more than he loved anybody else.
True indeed.
But keep reading.
4. And when his brethren saw that their father loved him more than all his brethren, they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him.
And his brothers saw it. So they hated their own brother. And they couldn't speak peaceably about him. Couldn't say nothing good about him because they hated him. Skip down to verse 12.
Verse 5, I'm sorry. And Joseph dreamed a dream, and he told it his brethren, and they hated him yet more.
So he told them a dream, and he told it to his brethren, and they hated him even more. He was just turning the screws on them. But he didn't know. He was just being Joseph.
Right.
But skip down to verse 12 and read it.
And his brethren went to feed their father's flocks in Shechem. And Israel said unto Joseph, do not thy brethren feed the flock in Shechem? Come, and I will send thee unto them. And he said to him, here I am. And he said to him, go, I pray thee, see whether it be well with thy brethren and well with the flocks, and bring me word again. So he sent him out of the vale of Hebron, and he came to Shechem.
So Jacob sent Joseph out there to do what he does naturally, spy on his brothers and bring back the report. So skip down to verse 19 and read it.
And they said one to another, behold, this dreamer cometh. Come now, therefore, and let us slay him and cast him into some pit. And we will say some evil beast have devoured him, and we shall see what will become of his dreams.
So now they're plotting to kill Joseph. They already hate him. But now that hate has turned into murder. It has festered into something that went beyond hate. Food for thought. Go ahead.
21. And Reuben heard it and delivered him out of their hands and said, let us not kill him. And Reuben said unto them, shed no blood, but cast him into this pit that it is in the wilderness, and lay no hand upon him, that he might rid him out of their hands to deliver him to his father again. And it came to pass, when Joseph was coming to his brethren, that they stripped Joseph of his coat of many colors that was on him.
So Reuben said, look, don't kill him. Just throw him in the pit. But his whole M.O. was to, once everybody's gone, he was going to come back and get him.
Right.
And send him back to Joseph. But something happened. When they found him, they stripped him, took his coat, because they hated that coat. Because his daddy gave it to him because he loved him so much. They hated that coat. Verse 24, read it.
And they took him and cast him into a pit, and the pit was empty. There was no water in it. And they sat down to eat bread. And they lifted up their eyes and looked, and behold, a company of Ishmaelites came from Gilead with their camels bearing spicery and balm and myrrh, going to carry it down to Egypt.
So now they threw him in the pit, and then they sat down to eat while he in that pit screaming. I imagine he was screaming.
Yeah.
And they sitting down eating bread like ain't nothing happened. Verse 26, read.
And Judah said unto his brethren, what profit is it if we slay our brother and conceal his blood?
So Judah, he want to make some money. He's like, look, man, we ain't got no profit if we kill our brother and conceal his blood. We got to get some money off of this dude. Go ahead.
Come, and let us sell him to the Ishmaelites, and let not our hand be upon him. For he is our brother in our flesh, and his brethren were content. Then there passed by Midianite merchantmen, and they drew and lifted up Joseph out of the pit, and sold Joseph to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver. and they brought Joseph into Egypt.
So now Judah came to his senses, because remember, Judah wanted to kill him first. But then Reuben talked him out of it. But apparently they was going to sit there and wait for this cat to die, because they threw him in the pit. But while they sitting there eating, Judah came to his sister and said, look, we ain't got to kill him. Let's sell him, get some money off of him. But anyway, evil thoughts, trying to kill your own brother. Exodus 22. Exodus 22. So out of the heart proceeds evil thoughts, adultery, fornication, murder, and thefts. You got to think before you steal. True. So you don't get caught. And the reason you get caught is you don't know when to stop, because it get too easy. And then you get caught. Exodus 22. 22 and verse 1. Read it.
If a man shall steal an ox or a sheep and kill it or sell it, he shall restore 5 oxen for an ox and 4 sheep for a sheep.
So if a man steal an ox, he got to restore it. That's the way the Lord said. You steal, you got to restore what you stole. Go ahead.
If a thief be found breaking up and be smitten that he die, there shall no blood be shed for him.
So if you find a thief breaking up, that means he in your house. This is home invasion right here.
Breaking up.
He is in your house stealing. You might come home and see him. Shoot him.
Right.
This is what the books say. And you smite him. Shoot him.
That's what it says.
Some states you can do that. Shoot him. Go ahead.
3. If the sun be risen upon him, there shall be blood shed for him, for he should make full restitution. If he have nothing, then he shall be sold for his theft.
So if he get away with it and you catch him, you can't shed his blood. The ones that's out to get him, these are the avengers that's coming to get him. No, y'all ain't going to kill him. He going to make restitution for what he stole. Verse 4, read it.
If the theft be certainly found in his hand alive, whether it be ox or ass or sheep, he shall restore double.
So he's going to restore double if what he stole is found alive in his hand. Go to Luke 10. Luke 10. So you got to think about stuff before you steal, and it's all evil. It's evil. All the way down to them good grapes that you open up in the grocery store. Don't they look good to eat? You stealing. You didn't pay for that grape. Stole it.
Good grapes.
They got you on camera.
You crazy.
Go to Luke 10. Luke 10, one verse, verse 30. And this is the parable of the Samaritan. Good Samaritan, but I'm going here for this, because that Samaritan got jumped. He got jumped. And the book going to tell you he did. 10 and 30, read it.
And Jesus answering said, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment and wounded him and departed, leaving him half dead.
So a certain man went down from Jerusalem. He on the travel. He on a journey. He just traveling. And you know people be lying and waiting for people to rob them.
Tourists.
And that's what they did. Tourists, they do. People know. They know who to get and who not to get. But these cats, I'm telling you, they thought about it. And that's how you do when you're a thief. We have some former thieves in here, don't we?
Yes, we do.
Former thieves.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go to... John 12. John 12.
Not no more.
Let's start at verse 1. Let's look at this guy, the thief of thieves. 12 and 1, read it.
Then Jesus, 6 days before the Passover, came to Bethany, where Lazarus where Lazarus was, which had been dead, whom he raised from the dead. There they made him a supper, and Martha served, but Lazarus was one of them that sat at the table with him. Then took Mary a pound of ointment of spikenard, very costly, and anointed the feet of Jesus, and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the odor of the ointment.
So now Mary took this ointment, and it was costly. I mean, this is some expensive stuff. You know, this is that Chanel number 5 or whatever it is. This is some expensive stuff. Go ahead.
4. Then saith one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, which should betray him, why was not this ointment sold for 300 pence and given to the poor?
Now that sounds like a good intention, don't it? You know, let's sell this ointment. Why wasn't this ointment sold so we can get the money and give it to the poor? But go ahead.
This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief and had the bag and bare what was put therein.
So Judas didn't have no intentions on the poor, even though he said it verbally. What was in his mind?
Getting that money.
Getting the money.
Leroy.
Because he had the money bag.
Mm-hmm. Leroy Thompson.
Let's go to John 13. Flip right over to John 13. So Judas's whole MO was money. He didn't care how he got it because he was a thief. He didn't care.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing about it, he was walking with Jesus for 3.5 years.
Mm-hmm.
He saw the things Jesus did. But his whole mindset was all about the money. He didn't care.
Nope.
Money, money, money. Let's go to John 13, verse 1. Read.
Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour was come, that he should depart out of this world into the Father, having loved his own, which were in the world, he loved them unto the end. And supper being ended, the devil, having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given
all... Okay, that's good on that. Oh. So now, since Judas's M.O. was all about money anyway, Satan already put it in his mind. You can betray Jesus, man, for 30 pieces of silver. Hmm. But that ointment, that stuff was worth 300. So he betrayed Jesus for what? 30 pieces of silver. That was his whole MO, was money. That's all he wanted was money. He was a thief. So he sold Jesus out for 30 pieces of silver. Let's go to Joshua 7. I took this out, but I'm going to put it in. I took it out the lesson, but I'm going to throw it in there. Y'all just bear with me because we're going to start wrapping it up anyway. Joshua 7. Joshua 7, because out of them, this is still under what we got, evil thoughts, adultery, fornication, murder, thefts, and covetousness. That proceeds out of the heart of a man as well. Mm-hmm. And this guy, he got his whole family killed. Joshua 7, verse 1. Just bear with me, y'all. Joshua 7, verse 1. Okay, read it.
But the children of Israel committed a trespass in the accursed thing. For Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerah, the tribe of Benjamin, took of the accursed thing. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against the children of Israel.
So now the Lord told Israel, when you take down Jericho, don't take nothing out of there. But somebody saw something, and they liked it, or they thought about it. They really thought about it, and they acted on their thinking. Verse 2, read it.
And Joshua sent men from Jericho to Ai, which is beside Beth Aven on the east side of Bethel, and spake unto them, saying, go up and view the country. And the men went up and viewed Ai. And they returned to Joshua and said unto him, let not all the people go up, but let about 2,000 or 3,000 men go up and smite Ai, and make not all the people to labor thither, for they are but a few.
So now Israel was going strong. It was knocking off everybody. They knocked off Jericho, and they saw another town. It was like, look, we just take a handful of people. We don't need all these people. We can go knock them off ourselves. So that's what they did. They sent up a handful of people, and what happened? Verse 5. 4, I'm sorry.
So there went up thither of the people about 3,000 men, and they fled before the men of Ai. And the men of Ai smote them, about 36 men, for they chased them from before the gate even to Shabirim, and smote them in the going down. Wherefore the hearts of the people melted and became as water.
So now they done lost their courage. Something went wrong. Something happened. So Joshua rent his clothes, fell upon the earth before the ark of the Lord, and was praying like crazy. Skip down to verse 10. Let's see what the Lord told him. Verse 10, go ahead.
And the Lord said unto Joshua, get thee up. Wherefore liest thou upon thy face? Israel have sinned. And they have also transgressed my covenant, which I commanded them, for they have even taken of the accursed thing, and have also stolen and disassembled also, and have put it even among their own stuff.
So now Israel had messed up. Somebody did something. The Lord told Joshua, get up. Fix this right now. Verse 12, read it.
Therefore, the children of Israel could not stand before their enemies, but turned their backs before their enemies because they were accursed. Neither will I be with you anymore, except ye destroy the accursed from among you.
So you better find out what happened and destroy the accursed thing from among you. Skip down to verse 15 and read it.
And it shall be that he that is taken with the accursed thing shall be burnt with fire, he and all that he hath, because he has transgressed the covenant of the Lord, and because he have wrought folly in Israel.
So the Lord was real particular. Now, when you find this cat, burn him up. Burn him. 17, read it. 16, go ahead.
So Joshua rose up early in the morning and brought Israel by their tribe, and the tribe of Judah was taken. So
now we're doing the process of elimination. He's going tribe by tribe, and now he came across Judah. And now he's going to break it all the way down to the family. And now they done found the dude that did it. Verse 18, read it.
And he brought his household man by man, and Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerah, of the tribe of Judah, was taken. And Joshua said unto Achan, my son, pray, I give thee glory to the Lord God of Israel, and make confession unto him, and tell me now what thou hast done. Hide it not from me.
So he was smooth talking. You know, you come on, Achan, just tell me what happened, man. I promise won't nothing happen to you. Ain't nothing going to happen. Make a confession. Clear your conscience, because I know you did it. But go ahead.
20. And Achan answered Joshua and said, indeed, I have sinned against the Lord God of Israel, and thus have I done.
He said, I'm sorry, I sinned. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. And he told him what he did. Verse 21, go ahead.
And when I saw among the spoils a goodly Babylonian garment.
Now, I don't know what Babylonian's garment is, but it had to be top of the line. Go ahead.
And 200 shekels of silver and a wedge of gold of 50 shekels weight. Then I coveted them and took them. And behold, they are hid in the earth in the midst of my tent and the silver under it.
So he saw it, thought about it, coveted it, and took it. Keep reading.
22. So Joshua sent messengers, and they ran into the tent, and behold, it was hid in the tent, and the silver under it.
So Joshua had to make sure that it was there. So he sent the messengers, and they found it. Verse 23, read it.
And they took them out of the midst of the tent, and brought them unto Joshua, and unto all the children of Israel, and laid them out before the Lord. And Joshua, and all Israel with him, took Achan, the son of Zerah, and the silver, and the garment, and the wedge of gold, and his sons, and his daughters, and his oxen, and his asses, and his sheep, and his tent, and all that he had, and they brought them unto the valley of Achor. And Joshua said, why hast thou troubled us? The Lord shall trouble thee this day. And all Israel stoned him with stones and burned them with fire, after they had stoned them with stones.
I bet his tone of voice changed then. He wasn't smooth talking Achan then. He brought all that stuff out. He was like, why have you troubled us, man? So they stoned him with stones, and after they stoned him, they burned him up, just like the Lord said. Proverbs 21. Covetousness, man. Mm-hmm. Evil thoughts. That's what Jesus said. This is what defiles you. And then they end up getting you cut off. Mm-hmm. Proverbs 21. And we're going to read verse 25. Proverbs 21 and verse 25. Okay, read.
The desire of the slothful killeth him.
The desire of the slothful. That's a lazy man. He lazy. He don't do no work, so he ain't got nothing. So his desire is what? To want all the time. Hmm. Go ahead.
For his hands refuse to labor.
That's a lazy man. He do not want to work. If you don't work, my father, you say, if you don't work, you don't eat. 26, read it.
He coveteth greedily all the day long.
All day long. He's wanting, looking at things. Hmm. All day long. Go ahead.
But the righteous giveth and spareth not.
But the righteous giveth and spareth not. But a lazy man don't want to work, but he want everything.
That's bad.
Let's go to Leviticus 24. Leviticus 24. Dealt with covenant, let's deal with some blasphemy now. Because all this stuff defile a man. We almost done. Leviticus 24, verse 10. We're going to start there. 24 and 10. Okay, read.
The son of an Israelitish woman, whose father was an Egyptian, went out among the children of Israel, and this son of the Israelitish woman and a man of Israel strove together in the camp.
So now you got the son of Israelitish woman. Father was an Egyptian. Because remember, mixed multitude came out of Egypt.
That's right.
So I'm quite sure some Egyptians came with him after they saw what the Lord was doing to Egypt. So he had an Israelite. He married an Israelite. They had a son. And the son of the woman and another man, they was fighting. Go ahead.
And the Israelitish woman's son blasphemed the name of the Lord and cursed. And they brought him unto Moses. And his mother's name was Shelomith, the daughter of Debri of the tribe of Dan.
So now all of a sudden things got heated and somebody said something they wasn't supposed to say. And it cost this dude his life. Go ahead.
And they put him in ward that the mind of the Lord might be showed them.
So we got to see what the Lord is thinking. Because we know the Lord's thinking is righteous. Mm-hmm. And let's see how righteous his thinking was in this instance. Go ahead.
And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, bring forth him that hath cursed without the camp, and let all that heard him lay their hands upon his head, and let all the congregation stone him. And thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel, saying, whosoever curseth his God shall bear his sin.
So this ain't no joke. You blaspheme the name of the Lord, it's over. He may not get you now, but keep on doing what you're doing. Payback is at the end of the line.
Sure, yeah.
He will get you. He ain't getting away with nothing. I seen the billboard. They showed this thing on this billboard out here. And do you believe in? It was something. It was questioning in God. In plain view, a billboard on the freeway. This world is getting wicked. They are getting wicked. But anyway. 16, read it.
And he that blasphemeth the name of the Lord, he shall surely be put to death. And all the congregations shall certainly stone him, as well as the stranger, as he that is born in the land, when he blasphemeth the name of the Lord, shall be put to death.
So the Lord is even-handed. Israel, don't get a pass, or the stranger either. You blaspheme the name of the Lord, get a rock upside your head. Job 2. So let's look at this, Job 2. We're almost done. Almost. Job chapter 2. We on schedule. We started late anyway. Job chapter 2. Now here's the instance right here where the whole thing in this scenario was Satan wanted to get Job to curse God and die. But Job didn't curse God. So Satan went through another direction. Mm-hmm. Job 2 and verse 1, read it.
Again, there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them to present himself before the Lord. And the Lord said unto Satan, From whence comest thou? And Satan answered the Lord and said, From going to and fro in the earth, and from walking up and down in it. And the Lord said unto Satan, Hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil, and still he holdeth fast his integrity, although thou movest me against him to destroy him without cause.
So everything, a lot of things happened to Job. His children got killed, lost all his material gain, but he still maintained his integrity. He said, The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away.
Yes, sir.
And that's the truth.
Yes, sir.
Everything you got it from the Lord, even your very life.
Yes, sir.
So praise God, whatever you got. Got a job, praise God. Ain't got no job, keep praising God.
Yep.
Don't stop.
Nope.
Having problems at home, praise God. Children acting up, praise God. Straighten them out.
Right.
But go ahead, keep reading.
4. And Satan answered the Lord and said, Skin for skin, yea, all that a man hath he will give for his life. But put forth thine hand now, and touch his bone and his flesh, and he will curse thee to thy face. And the Lord said unto Satan, Behold, he is in thine hand, but save his life.
So put something on him. Give him some kind of sickness, some disease. I bet you he'll curse you. And you can see that on TV sometimes. People, well, how can this, I can't believe God would let this happen. Better believe it.
Yeah.
And keep on believing. But, you know, that's people of little faith. They believed in that false God, the God of Sunday. But keep reading.
So went Satan forth from the presence of the Lord and smote Job with sore boils from the sole of his foot into his crown. And he took him a potsherd to scrape himself withal, and he sat down among the ashes.
So he had boils from head to toe. And he's sitting down scraping himself. And his wife, she having pity on him. Because it's like, the only way out of this, dude, is to die. And you want to die? Do this right here. Go ahead.
Then said his wife unto him, Dost thou still retain thine integrity? Curse God and die.
Now, where did this come from? This is coming from Satan. This is coming from Satan because this is what he wants Job to do. So he's going to come through every avenue to get you off of your square.
Yes, sir.
Whether it be friends, family, whoever it is.
Whoever.
That's why you got to look behind them, the spiritual wickedness in high places. So if you armed to the teeth, you can look beyond them and say, what did Job tell his wife?
But he said unto her, Thou speakest as one of the foolish women speaketh. What? Shall we receive good at the hand of God and shall not receive evil? And all this did not Job sin with his lips.
So he called his wife a fool. You got to be out your mind. Curse God and die? Please. And he kept on scraping. Let's go to Deuteronomy 15. Deuteronomy 15. Because we got to get to this evil eye, because that'll defile you too. The evil eye. And Jesus said all of this stuff. And all this stuff start up here, in the mind. That's why the title of the lesson is Thoughts of the Mind. They can be evil and they can be good. We just happen to be dealing with a lot of evil right now. But there's some good thoughts too. You can do a lesson on good thoughts. Because the Bible said the thoughts of the mind and spirit. Deuteronomy, right?
Yes, sir.
15.
Yes, sir.
15 and 7, read it.
If there be among you a poor man of one of thy brethren within all thy gates in the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, thou shalt not harden thine heart, nor shut thine hand from thy poor brother.
So now here's a brother now. The books say, if there's a poor man from among your brethren within any of thy gates in the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, don't harden your heart, nor shut your hand from your poor brother.
Right.
Help him out. Go ahead.
But thou shalt open thine hand wide unto him, and shall surely lend him sufficient for his need in that which he wanteth. Beware that there be not a thought in thy wicked heart, saying, the seventh year, the year of release is at hand, and thine eye be evil against thy poor brother, and thou givest him not, and he crieth unto the Lord against thee, and it be sin unto thee.
So now you see, he said, beware that there be not an evil thought in thy wicked heart, saying, because the seventh year is the year of release.
Right.
You release him, and get a lot of food to go with it. But you're going to wait around. Now, this is seventh year coming up. Mm-hmm. I ain't going to give him nothing. He going to get paid anyway when the seventh year come up. No. That's what you're thinking. But the Lord said, beware. Don't think that. If you see him in hurting, help him out. Go ahead.
10. Thou shalt surely give him, and thine heart shall not be grieved when thou givest unto him.
So don't be giving it grudgingly. Give it to him and be happy because you're helping him out. Go ahead.
Because that for this thing the Lord thy God shall bless thee in all thy works, and in all that thou puttest thine hand unto. For the poor shall never cease out of the land. Therefore I command thee, saying, thou shalt open thy hand wide unto thy brother, to thy poor, and to thy needy in thy land.
So the poor will never cease out of the land. Right. Poverty is everywhere.
Correct.
It's all over the world. In some form or another, but it's everywhere. Let's go to Proverbs 24. We on the last one, deceit. Proverbs 24, one verse, verse 8. Okay, read.
He that deviseth to do evil shall be called a mischievous person.
So he that deviseth to do evil, and what does devise mean? I got this dictionary right here. Read that.
This is coming from Webster's New Explorer Large Print Dictionary, page 174, excuse me. Devise, invent, plot.
Invent or plot to do what? Evil. He that devises to do evil shall be called a mischievous person, an evil person. You plotting to do evil, you're an evil person.
Yep.
That's
straight
it.
Straight up.
And we see all this plotting. When the evil thoughts come in, you're plotting all this stuff. Adultery, fornication, murder, thefts, covetousness, blasphemy, and the evil eye. Let's go to Romans 1. So now you're doing all this plotting, these evil thoughts. The Lord will deal with you. He will deal with you. You want to have an evil mind? He'll let you have at it.
You sure will.
And won't even think twice about it.
Man.
Romans 1, verse 24, read it.
Wherefore, God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves.
So God will give you up to the lust of your own mind.
Mm-hmm.
Keep on thinking crazy. All of a sudden, craziness is going to take over.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to be back door. Go ahead.
Who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshiped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause, God gave them up unto vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature.
So we see we got a domino effect here. You steady going down. You went from uncleanness to vile affection.
Mm.
Go ahead. Women changing their own natural use of that which is against nature.
Mm.
The animal kingdom got it right.
Real talk.
But mankind and his, finite wisdom try to please everybody against nature. Same-sex marriage against nature. It's against nature. This is what the book say. How come don't nobody read this?
Hmm.
Go ahead.
27. and likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of a woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error, which was meet. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient.
So the Lord will turn you over to a reprobate mind. This whole world is reprobate.
Yep.
Go ahead.
Being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whispers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful.
And Jesus said some of these things out of the mind precedes all of this stuff.
Yup.
So God will turn you over to a reprobate mind. And once you got the reprobate mind, it is a done deal. It's just a matter of time before you die in your iniquity. Mm-hmm. Let's go to Romans 16. Romans 16. So don't let them evil thoughts shake them off.
Shake them off.
Don't let them fester. Because if one of them fester, then another one going to come up too. You might be stealing. Stealing always leads to murder.
Yeah, yeah.
Because eventually somebody going to come home and see you. Now you got to kill them. Your intentions may not be to kill them, but you're going to end up doing it anyway because you don't know when to stop. Romans 16, verse 17, read it.
Now, I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned, and avoid them. For they that are such serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by good works and fair speeches deceive the hearts of the simple.
So mark those that ain't on the same program and avoid them. They come up in here every now and then.
Mm-hmm.
We got them marked. We avoid them, keep them in check in a godly manner, because we got people watching to see how we handle things, especially the Lord is watching. But you avoid them. They're coming here with, you know, say a few things here and there. They try to pick off the weak people. They will never come up to the teacher. They want to get some people out there in the flock. Well, have you seen this? You know what this lost book here, you know? Did you read this? Avoid them, because the books say that they serve not the Lord, but their own belly, and with good words, slick talk, deceive what? The minds of the simple.
Of the simple.
The simple ones they get. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 3. We're still in deceit. 1 Corinthians 3, and pick it up at verse 18. Okay, read it.
Let no man deceive himself. If any man among you seemeth to be wise in this world, let him become a fool, that he may be wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God, for it is written, he taketh the wise in their own craftiness. And again, the Lord knoweth the thoughts of the wise, that they are vain.
So the wisdom in this world is nothing to God. You think you something, you ain't nothing. Because the Lord give you something, praise him for it.
Yes, sir.
Don't think you came up with this on your own.
Praise the Lord on that one.
I done went to 50 different universities and got this, this, and that, and I did it all myself. Right. The Lord will strike you crazy. Now what? All them degrees going out the window. So praise God. The wisdom of this world ain't nothing to the Lord. It's nothing. He'll take the wisdom of a man and what it say? Verse 19. Read that again.
For the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God. For it is written, he taketh the wise in their own craftiness.
That's right. He will get you. Let's go to Ecclesiastes 10. That's it. Ecclesiastes 10. I can't do these colors no more, man. I know, but. Ecclesiastes 10. One verse, verse 20. Hold on, let me get that. Okay, one verse 20, read it.
Curse not the king, no, not in thy thought, and curse not the rich in thy bedchamber.
So don't curse the king in your thoughts, and don't curse the rich when you're laying in your bed, because now you're by yourself thinking crazy. But don't think the Lord can't hear it. Go ahead.
For a bird of the air shall carry the voice, and that which have wings shall tell the matter.
So the Lord hears, he sees it all, and he hears it all too. Even when you're laying down asleep thinking crazy, the Lord will hear it. Let's go to Matthew 5. Matthew chapter 5. We'll read a couple of verses here, 27 and 28. Okay, go ahead.
Have you not heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery?
And that's in the law. Go ahead.
But I say unto you, that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart.
So you done messed up. Looking and lusting, your mind is jacked up already.
Mm-hmm.
And if you keep looking and you keep lusting, you're going to act on it.
Mm-hmm.
The next thing you know, you back door. Luke 6. Flip over to Luke 6. Keep your mind in check. Luke 6 and verse 6. Okay, read it.
And it came to pass, also on another Sabbath, that he entered into the synagogues and taught. And there was a man whose right hand was withered, and the scribes and Pharisees watched him.
Now, contrary to popular belief, Jesus kept the Sabbath day. He kept it because it's in the law.
Yup.
So I don't know who that Jesus is tomorrow. I do know, but he ain't got nothing to do with this Jesus. Because this Jesus kept the Sabbath day, which is the seventh day of the week, which just happens to be today.
Yes, sir.
Keep reading.
Whether he would heal on the Sabbath, that they might find an accusation against him.
So now the Pharisees looking at Jesus to see if he's going to heal on the Sabbath. Like there's something wrong with healing somebody on the Sabbath day. Go ahead.
But he knew their thoughts and said to the man which had the withered hand, rise up and stand forth in the midst. And he arose and stood forth. Then said Jesus unto them, I will ask you one thing. Is it lawful on the Sabbath to do good or to do evil, save life or to destroy it?
So now Jesus, he knew their thoughts. He knew what they was thinking because they had that little bubble on the top with their words.
Yeah.
He knew what they was thinking. Go ahead.
And looking round about them all, he said unto them, said unto the man, stretch forth thine hand. And he did so, and his hand was restored whole as the other. And they were filled with madness and communed one with another what they might do to Jesus.
Now, he healed a man on the Sabbath day. The man had a withered hand, and he healed it on the Sabbath. What's wrong with that? So they filled with what? Madness.
Madness.
They looking to kill him now.
Murder.
Evil thoughts festering in their mind. Jeremiah 7, Matthew 16. Matthew 16. Back to Matthew. Okay, read.
From that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised again the third day. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, Be it far from thee, Lord. This shall not be unto thee.
So Jesus was telling the disciples, look, I got to die. I'm going to be dead for 3 days and I'm coming up. I got to suffer. But Peter, you know, Jesus' right-hand man, he's like, no, Lord, this ain't going to happen. Good intentions.
Mm-hmm.
Trying to protect him.
Mm-hmm.
Don't talk like that. That ain't going to happen to you. Go ahead.
But he turned and said unto Peter, Get thee behind me, Satan. Thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men.
So he looked behind Peter and said, Look, get behind me, Satan. Just like Job's wife.
Mm-hmm.
This is Satan talking. Through Job's wife, also through Peter.
Yeah.
That's why Job called her a fool, went on about his scraping. Jesus said, Satan, get behind me. Because you savor the thoughts. You don't savor the thoughts of God, but those things that be of men.
Right.
Let's go to Jeremiah now, 17. So anybody that's out there trying to please the world, better watch them. Trying to look good in front of the world, give all this money to charity. You know, all this humanitarian type stuff. What about some godly type stuff?
Yeah, real talk.
Jeremiah 17. We're going to start at verse 5. Okay, read.
Thus saith the Lord, Cursed be the man that trusteth in man.
Cursed be the man that trusteth in man. You trust in man, I guarantee you cursed. Because man will not deliver you. He will only let you down. Go ahead.
And maketh flesh his arm, and whose heart departeth from the Lord.
So if you're putting all your trust in man, I guarantee you your mind is off of the Lord. Because you're looking for man to deliver you. You're looking for the man to pay your bills. You're looking for man to repay you for all this slavery that you've been through. That ain't happening.
Never.
Skip down to verse 9 and read it.
The heart is deceitful above all things.
The heart, none other than the mind. The mind is deceitful. Your own mind will trick you. Above all things, go ahead.
And desperately wicked.
And desperately wicked. We done read a whole bunch of stuff how wicked the mind is. Go ahead.
Who can know it? I, the Lord, search the heart. I try the reins, even to give every man according to his ways. And according to the fruit of his doings.
So who searches the mind? The Lord. So he know exactly what you're doing and what you're thinking. And you're going to get rewarded according to the fruit of your doings. You could be dumb, which means you just can't talk.
Right.
But you can think evil. And you're still going to be accountable for that. Let's go to Job 24. We're going to wrap it up. Job 24. Let's look at this right here, because this takes some plot. This is going to sum it up right here. An evil mind. Out of the thought proceeds evil thoughts, adultery, fornication, murder, theft, covetousness, blasphemy, evil eye, deceit, and all this other bad stuff. 24, verse 1, read it.
Why, seeing times are not hidden from the Almighty, do they that know him not see his days?
So why, seeing times are not hidden, the Lord, ain't nothing hid from the Lord. So if you know this, why do you continue to do crazy?
Mm.
Go ahead.
Some remove the landmarks. They violently take away flocks and feed thereof.
Some remove the landmarks, violently take away flocks that feed. This is all the stuff people are doing because they don't think the Lord is looking at them. Skip down to verse 4 and read it.
They turn the needy out of the way. The poor of the earth hide themselves together.
Verse 6.
They reap everyone his corn in the field, and they gather the vintage of the wicked.
Everybody is out for themselves. Skip down to verse 10 and read it.
They cause him to go naked without clothing, and they take away the sheaf from the hungry.
People are doing this, and they think the Lord ain't watching. How can somebody have all the money in the world, and you got somebody on the street that's in the garbage can looking for some food? That don't make no sense. I've seen this stuff where people got all this money, millions. I don't believe this. Somebody paid actually $50 million for a car. And it's somebody on the street ain't got nothing to eat. And you could just throw away money like that. Wow. How much money do you have that you can actually pay $50 million for a car? That's crazy. But anyway. Skip, we read verse 10?
Yes.
Yeah, skip down to verse 13 and read it.
They are of those that rebel against the light. They know not the ways thereof, nor abide in the paths thereof.
Go ahead.
The murderer, rising with the light, killeth the poor and needy, and in the night is as a thief. The eye also of the adulterer waiteth for the twilight, saying, no eye shall see me, and disguiseth his face.
This dude plotting. Go ahead.
In the dark, they dig through houses, which they had marked for themselves in the daytime. They know not the light.
And they think the Lord don't see this. He see it all.
That's a good one.
Let's go to Proverbs 21. I got two more places. Proverbs 21. People are crazy if they don't think the Lord ain't watching.
Man.
Proverbs 21. One verse. 27. Okay, read.
The sacrifice of the wicked is abomination.
So the sacrifice of the wicked, now, that's an abomination. The Bible says the person that turns his ear from hearing the law, even his prayer,
yes,
is an abomination.
Yes, sir.
So if you ain't keeping the law and you praying to the Lord, he ain't hearing it. Your prayer is an abomination. So the sacrifice of a wicked is an abomination. What else?
How much more when he bringeth it with a wicked mind?
So you got a double whammy on you. You're already wicked, and now you're bringing it with a wicked mind.
That's interesting.
That is crazy.
Mm-hmm.
But there's people out there like that. Isaiah 55. We're going to wrap it up right here. Isaiah 55. Isaiah 55, start at verse 6. Isaiah 55, verse 6. Okay, read it.
Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near.
So seek the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. Go ahead.
Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon.
So as long as you're breathing, you got a chance. If you're wicked, turn from your wickedness. Turn to the Lord. Because once you stop breathing, it's over with. Verse 8, read it.
For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord.
So our thoughts are not his thoughts. The Lord's thinking is on a whole different level.
Man.
He'll kill somebody and we'll think it's wrong, but it's right to him. That's some righteous killing. And let's go to the last place, 2 Corinthians 10. 2 Corinthians 10. Pick it up at verse 1. 10 and 1. Go ahead.
Now, I, Paul, myself beseech you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ, who in the presence am base among you, but being absent am bold toward you. But I beseech you that I may not be bold when I am present with that confidence wherewith I think to be bold against some which think of us as if we walked according to the flesh. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh.
That's right. Even though we're in this flesh, we still got to maintain our servitude to the Lord. Our works have to show that we're not walking in this flesh. Because we know what the attributes of the flesh are. All the stuff we've been reading here. Well, even though we're in this flesh, we're not in this flesh when it comes to the mind. Go ahead.
For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds.
So the weapons of our warfare is what? The whole armor of God.
Yes, sir.
It ain't no gun. It ain't no knife. It ain't no slingshot. It's this Bible right here. The whole armor. Go ahead.
Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ.
I hope you got some understanding in Jesus' name.
We welcome you and hope today's lesson increased your knowledge of the Holy Bible. CDs and DVDs of the Sabbath lessons are available. Please place your order and donation in an offering envelope, and it will be filled on the next Sabbath. The children's class, ages 4 through 12, starts at 11:30 a.m. every Sabbath. Bring your child so that their knowledge may be increased. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Proverbs 22:6. Teenage question and answer, ages 13 through 19, starts 45 minutes after the Sabbath lesson. We have question and answer every Wednesday at 5 o'clock p.m. via telephone conference line. The number and access code are located at the top of the lesson, or see the live stream of question and answer at www.thykingdomcome7.com. If you are interested in being baptized, please place your name on the list at the literature table. Remember to follow the dress code when attending our services. Men should remove all hats and all head coverings during the service times. Women should wear a head covering such as a hat or scarf during the service. Women should not wear tight-fitting pants or skirts or revealing clothing. Attire should be modest according to the Bible. If your child becomes restless during the Bible lesson, we encourage you to remove your child from the room until he or she has settled, or you and your child can watch the service from the family room. Your tithes and offerings are always appreciated. Please place your tithes and offerings in an offering envelope and deposit it in the offering box. Your cooperation is greatly appreciated. Again, thank you for coming, and we hope to see you on the next Sabbath. Peace.